I want to welcome you to worship this day. My name is Sarah Merriweather, and I'm the Executive Director here at Jerome Church. Today we are continuing our Lenten series called Remember, which is based on the book and video study by author Susan Robb. If you would like to grow more in your faith during this Lenten season, you can find the links to those resources, the book and the video study, in today's video links. Over the past few weeks, we've been talking about the covenants that God makes with God's people as we follow Jesus to the cross. And today, we are exploring the story of Jeremiah and the hope of a new covenant. I invite you to go ahead and get out your Grow resource and your Church Center apps so that you can connect to everything that's happening in worship today. And let's now begin together in worship and praise.
Hello, Church. My name is Tara Moore, and I'm the Family Ministry Director and Student Ministry Coordinator here at Jerome. As we prepare to hear today's message, I want to invite you to connect with us during this time of online worship together. During worship today, I invite you to use the chat or comment function on any platform that you're watching to join the conversation and share your thoughts or prayer concerns with our staff and online worshiping congregation. I also invite you to connect to the Church Center app, which is our app and online resource that virtually connects you to things like our Connect card, signups for upcoming events, worship videos and resources, kids and family resources, and our online giving platform so that you can support the ministries and missions of Jerome Church. You can scan the QR code on the screen to connect or visit jeromechurch.org/church-center. Today, we are continuing our Lent series called Remember. Let's join together now and listen to today's message from Sarah.
So today we are continuing our Lent series called Remember. For the past 4 weeks, Pastor Bruce has been taking us through some of the major covenants that we find in the Old Testament, these covenants that God makes with God's people. So we've talked about Noah and the promise for creation, about Abraham and a promise of nations. We've heard about Moses and this promise of freedom and the rules that give us freedom and govern the ways that we love God and love each other. And last week we heard about David, where God promised a name and a place. Today we are going to be talking about Jeremiah. And this prophet, as we will see here, gives us the promise of a new covenant. So as we look at the covenants on the surface, these covenants, they might seem like contracts or rules or even promises. But what we've come to understand over these past 4 weeks is that what they're really about is relationship. So we see examples of how we as God's people keep falling away and God keeps reclaiming us. We've learned that God wants to rescue us and restore us into right relationship and offers us rescue over and over again, even today. So as I mentioned, today we're talking about the prophet Jeremiah. And I think it's important to understand how we got here. So over these past few weeks, Pastor Bruce has been giving us some biblical history each week, centuries of history in about 2 minutes. So I'm going to do my best today to catch us up from where we found ourselves last week with David to today where we find ourselves with Jeremiah. So where are we in the history of Israel? So first of all, it's been 400 years since the time of David. The relationship between God and people has changed, and friends, it has not changed for the better. The Israelites have broken God's covenant, mostly the Ten Commandments. They're worshiping other gods, the priests, the kings, the prophets. They're not leading people into the right things. And in fact, this led to rampant social injustice. Things like not caring for the orphans or the widows or the immigrants. The 12 tribes of Israel are no longer one nation. So after the death of Solomon, who was David's son, the kingdom divided. The 10 tribes that weren't loyal to David become the northern kingdom. And the 2 tribes that remained loyal to David are Judah and Benjamin. And they become the southern kingdom, or we know them as Judah, which includes, importantly, Jerusalem. So by the time we find ourselves here with Jeremiah, the northern kingdom has been captured by the Assyrians and exiled. And so now God appoints Jeremiah as a prophet to Israel and the nations and warns through Jeremiah that the same thing will happen to Judah. So the prophet Jeremiah prophesies that if the people continue to turn their back on God, that all of Jerusalem will become a wasteland. He does some pretty dramatic things to explain this. It's worth reading if you get into the book of Jeremiah. But he calls the king and the people to repent before it's too late, and that they are also brought into the same destruction and exile that their friends in the northern kingdom are already experiencing. Now, here's a quick spoiler. We know that this happens because, sort of by the end of this story, they're soon exiled by the Babylonians in the southern kingdom. So Jeremiah brings us a lot of doom and gloom. He's warning the people of Judah who failed in their faith. They have lost this right relationship with God that God had rescued them from with these covenants over and over. But Jeremiah offers something else. And what he offers is a hope of what's to come. And Jeremiah offers this through a new covenant. Which brings us to today's scripture reading. And I'm reading from the New International Version translation. I invite you to open up your Bibles and follow along, or open up the YouVersion app and listen or read as we have the scripture here today. I'm reading from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 31, verses 31 through 34. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt, because they broke my covenant, though I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, "Know the Lord," because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. So here God promises a new covenant through the words of Jeremiah. God says that it will not be like the one that he made with Moses. We find that in verse 32. This new covenant will not be written on stone tablets like the Ten Commandments, but instead, what God says through Jeremiah is that God is writing his law of love on our hearts. So God promises a new covenant, and as Christians, we understand this new covenant to be fulfilled through Jesus. God wants our hearts, and so he gives us a Savior. What God wants here, friends, is our hearts. So I have a question for you here today. Have any of you ever heard or been told, or maybe you've told someone to follow your heart? Sometimes we say things like, "Follow your heart, it will never lead you astray," or "Follow your heart, you can trust it, it knows the way." These things sound good, and maybe it's advice that you've even given or perhaps even believed, but I'm going to suggest today that too often what our hearts lead us to is really not at all what God wants for us. So while we're trying to answer our own prayers and follow our own hearts, God is right there, seeking us and desiring a close and right relationship with us. So my husband and I, we've been married almost 20 years. This year we'll celebrate our 20th anniversary this September, but we've been together much longer than that. In fact, we are high school sweethearts. We met when I was 15 and he was 16, playing on the golf team together. And, you know, like any relationship, we truly and unconditionally love each other. And there is a lot of good in our relationship. My husband is my best friend. He's my life partner. We have two amazing kids. We still get to play golf together. But there have been some times over these past 28 years that have been tough. And before we were married and in college, we even had a couple of times where we broke up and we weren't together. And since marriage, there have been times where we were far from being on the same page. But as we love each other unconditionally, what we desire is this close and right relationship with each other. And so time and time again, when things go sideways or we find ourselves in a difficult time, we work to find our way back through these challenges and to each other. And for that, I am so grateful. You see, what we all want in our closest relationships, whether that's with our spouses, our children, our friends, our siblings, or with God, is that we want it to be right. We all long to be loved unconditionally for who we are. We want to know that those who love us most can look into our hearts and love us at our best and also at our worst. We want to know that their love spurs us to reciprocate love and that their love makes us want to be our best. Recognizing the depth of God's love for us can do the same thing. God wants to rescue us and restore us into a right relationship, and so God offers us rescue over and over and over again. So why does it matter that God has our heart? I'm going to give you four reasons why we all need to check the condition of our hearts and make sure that they're ready for God to write His law of love onto them. So the first one is, if God doesn't have your heart, everything else is out of whack. Friends, if God doesn't have your heart, you will be looking for ways to find happiness and you will always come up short, no matter how much time or money or job titles or accolades or trophies or cars or whatever else it is that you have. But if God has your heart, He has everything else. We begin to understand that none of it is ours, even to begin with, and this applies to that list I just named. So if God has your heart, He has your time, He has your money, He has your relationships, He has your job, He has all of it. The second thing is that we create our own personal exiles and hells. So like Jeremiah warned, we will be separated from God by our own doing if God doesn't have our hearts. We'll live self-centered instead of God-centered lives, and our fear and our impatience will keep us from an intimate and truly trusting relationship with God. Often our selfish desires will lead us to turn material things into idols. Have you ever done that? No, I have. We walk away from God, and our actions and our words and everything else alienate us from those that we love and who we want to love us. The third thing is that God wants a right relationship with you right now. Don't wait until you get to heaven. So we can argue about all kinds of things that really have no importance for eternity, and we do as people, right? But God is so clear about the expectation to have a right relationship with God right here, right now, that He sent His Son as the new covenant to make that relationship right. And the fourth reason that it matters that God has your heart, and I'll be honest, I'm skipping ahead a couple of weeks here, but spoiler, Jesus died on a cross for you and for me. How are we going to respond? There is nothing we can do about how much God loves us. But God ask for something in response to that incredible and unmerited love and grace, and that thing is our hearts. God wants our hearts, so He gave us a savior. So what if our hearts, what if your heart, what if my heart, what if we're in need of a little bit of heart realignment? You see, I am a loyal Jeep driver, and most of my vehicles have been Jeeps, particularly the one that saved my life in a pretty bad accident when I was 19 years old. But Jeeps are meant to be driven and over things like bumps and railroad tracks and sometimes curbs. You know, you get the point. But I mean, I'm a pretty good driver, but I have never seen a curb that I couldn't cut too close. And I mean that quite literally. I'm 5'2". It's hard for me to see over the wheel sometimes. But so when I take my Jeep in for regular service, the dealership usually sends me a text once they've got it in and ready to check it. And that text usually says something like, their courtesy alignment checker has discovered that my wheels are out of whack. And I don't usually question that too much. I usually just hit approve because of, well, like the bumps and the railroad tracks and the curbs. So friends, I want to you to consider this moment here as your courtesy alignment check for your heart. We can know that those last four things are true, but still, like the people of God thousands of years ahead of us and before us, we manage to mess things up and we find ourselves in need of rescue, even with a savior. So what do we do to get our hearts in alignment with God? First of all, Jesus gives us the greatest commandment. We have to love God. And in that greatest commandment, he tells us that the second is like it, and that is that we have to love people. In this new commandment that Pastor Bruce will teach us about more on Palm Sunday and as we move through to Maundy Thursday, we learn that, in fact, we are supposed to love people like Jesus loved them, meaning sacrificially. So in the United Methodist Church, we live out this call to love God and love people through a commitment to our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. So when we commit to these things, it gets our hearts back in alignment with God. So we know what to do, but how do we do it? The ideal here, friends, again, is that we want to be like Christ. But the expectation as disciples is that we are centering our lives on getting there. God isn't asking for perfection, but he is asking for us to move more and more into alignment with his will for our lives. So these commitments are not multiple choice. These prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness, it's all or one. All in one, I mean. But it doesn't mean that you have to do all of them this week. So I'm going to recommend that you just choose one this week to work on to get your heart in a little bit better alignment with God. So I'm going to give you some practical steps that you can take this week to better align your heart. The first one is, I'm going to invite you to pray. I want you to set up a time to pray each day. If you need some ideas, some things that work for me, I use a prayer journal. I also use the YouVersion app. They have a guided prayer each day, which is a really great thing. You can even follow Jerome Church on YouVersion, and we give you some prompts there. Set a reminder, but whatever you do, find some time to pray. Or maybe you need to work on your presence in worship. So don't just show up. Whether you're watching here online or you attend in person at Jerome Church or someone else, don't just show up. Prepare your heart to worship and glorify God. I work at a church, and so worship on Sunday morning sometimes for me can be a little bit tricky. But the thing that I like to do is I listen to praise music on my way to church on Sunday mornings. This gets me in the right frame of mind when I arrive ready to worship. The third practical step you can take is to give sacrificially. And yes, I'm talking about money here, but remember that if God has your heart, he has this too. Friends, I'm going to suggest that it is not the size of the gift that you give. It's the size of the sacrifice. What God wants is our heart and for us to give sacrificially. Another way that maybe you can get in better alignment with God is to serve this week. There are all kinds of opportunities through the missions and ministries of Jerome Church. A few are things like making soup or serving soup this upcoming Friday. You could pack or deliver diapers for the diaper angels. If you are worshiping in person, you could sign up to be a greeter or serve in our children's ministry. Whatever you do, whether you're worshiping online as your primary place of worship or here at Jerome Church in the building, I want to invite you to open up your Church Center app and click on the Find Your Three button and find some ways to serve this week. The last thing is witness, and this can be a tough one. I think sometimes we have a hard time sharing our faith with others, but I want to start with a low bar on this one for you. Just invite somebody to church. Easter's coming, and I promise you, someone is waiting for your invitation. If you don't believe me, it's okay. Ask them anyway. So our challenge is this. In a world and a culture that tells us to follow our hearts, and they mean it when they tell us that, it is not always popular, and it is rarely easy to follow a Savior. But here we are, called during this Lenten season to follow Jesus all the way to the cross. God chases us down, and all he wants is a right relationship with us. God wants our hearts, and so he gave us a Savior. So we'll continue to follow Jesus to the cross through the celebration of Palm Sunday next week, and then through the darkness of Good Friday and the tomb. But like God promised through Jeremiah, we know that we have hope for our future in this new covenant found in Jesus. Because God has written his word and his law of love on our hearts, we know in our heart that new life is coming. So as we continue this Lenten journey together, I invite you now to pray with me today as we close our time in worship. God, in a world where we are told to follow our hearts, help us to follow you instead. We ask you this week to write your laws of love and mercy and grace on our hearts so that others might know you by our love. Thanks be to you, God, this day, and amen. Have a blessed week, friends.
It's good to be with you again in worship today. Today we are continuing our Lent series called Remember, looking at the covenants of God as we follow Jesus to the cross. As we continue in worship together today, I want to invite you again to connect to all of the resources in Church Center, which is our online hub for engaging with the ministries of Jerome Church. While you are there, please be sure to check into worship or complete your Connect card today and take some time to explore the opportunities in the app, including upcoming events and ways to volunteer in a local mission or to grow deeper in your faith by participating in an upcoming class or study. A few ways that you can take a next step with God at Jerome Church include signing up to attend our next Discover Jerome class that will be held on Sunday, April 7th at 11:30 a.m. This is for anyone new to the congregation or for anyone interested in taking the next step of membership here at Jerome. I also want to invite you to join us for Holy Week and Easter in-person worship beginning with Maundy Thursday on March 28th at 7 p.m. On Good Friday, March 29th, we will join together for worship at 7 p.m. Then on Easter Sunday, we will celebrate our resurrected Savior through worship at 7 a.m., 9 a.m., and 10:30 a.m., and online worship at 9 and 10:30 a.m. You can learn more about all of the upcoming opportunities, including our Easter worship services at Jerome Church, as well as view the calendar and connect to signups through the Church Center app or by visiting our website at jeromechurch.org. The people of Jerome Church are committed to the mission that Jesus gave us, to love God and love people. And you can join us in this work by giving your regular financial offering and by giving to the special Easter offering supporting the missions of Jerome Church. You can give electronically through the links in today's video description, on the Jerome Church website, or donate online through the Give tab in the Church Center app. And if you have made the decision to give for the first time today, you can connect to our online giving platform by texting the word GIVE to 614-587-7871. You can also give through automatic withdrawal by contacting the church office or by mailing a check to Jerome Church at the address on the screen below. Our hope is that you will establish a regular pattern of giving so that you can join us in the great work that God is doing through the people of Jerome Church. As we end our time of worship together today, I want to say thank you for making this worship time a part of your week, whether you are joining us live on Sunday morning or watching later on demand. I want to invite you to connect with us online this week through our social media platforms and in the Church Center app, and know that we look forward to worshiping with you next week as we continue our journey through Lent with Palm Sunday worship. Have a blessed week, friends.